Welcome to Pot of Thunder, the recognized symbol of excellence in rock and roll podcasting, brought to you by Blue Microphones. Oh, they look great. I'm admiring this thing. They sound even better. Listen to me. I don't sound that good.
You almost went around the pop screen there.
I know.
That could have been dangerous.
Right on the edge. Ooh, I love that shimmery blue color. Delightful.
I don't think people fully appreciate the danger that gets brought to them every week.
Yep, right there. Podcasting on the edge, if there's a such thing. And who's that over there? Who are you, guy who's talking and stretching? Put your hands together for that man. Look at him. Look at him go. Polka dancing his way.
Putting on a show here.
Across the podcast studio, kicking his legs over his head. Nick Pollock.
Thanks for having me.
Thanks for attending.
Well.
Yes. And to your immediate left, let me just ask you, are you feeling young or are you feeling old?
You're asking me directly?
Yep.
I feel somewhere in the middle, I suppose.
Well, you got to pick one or the other. How are you feeling today, young or old?
I think I know where you're going with this, so I'll say young.
You're feeling young.
My goodness.
Well. Put your hands together for the breakout star of the podcast medium. That's Chris L. We are Pot of Thunder. That was Young Fogarty singing The Gunslinger.
Young Angrier Fogarty.
Yeah. Yes.
Gotta like it.
Mm-hmm. And if that wasn't enough, folks, we got one more. Saving the best for last. Yes! Returning to the program after a couple of years. From the swear. Kevin Williams.
What is up, Pot Nation?
Yeah.
So you're so happy to be back on.
Thank you for coming back. We're glad to have you. And you're somewhat local, but you decided,
Well,
I got real close, and then I just said, nah, I'm not going to come all the way.
Yeah, I mean, so here's the thing is, the last time he was here, he took probably a $90 Uber ride to get down to where we're at. And what did we do? Subjected him to the random song generator, and he got I Can't Stop the Rain.
That's right. I knew it was a Peter Criss solo.
Oh,
one,
man.
From That's Peter right. Criss, which, you know, in retrospect, not a bad song. We're not haters by any means of the Peter Criss 78 solo album, but you know, a rocker probably would have been preferable. And also, you know, we've since, with our guests, granted them the advantage of, on their first appearance with us, they get to pick the song. Mm. So given the fact that it's our anniversary month, a.k.a. Pot of Thunder month, is there a sound clip you should be playing?
Mm. There is.
So, given that this is the situation, we're going to make some amends here and right that wrong and grant Mr. Williams the honor of picking the song. And also should mention that not only is Kevin the bass player for the band The Swear, he is also one of the co-hosts of the fantastic podcast InObscuria.
Yes.
So I want to make sure everybody's aware of that show and should check it out. And it comes out every Friday. So as I say on social media, start your week with pot, end it with InObscuria.
That's right.
And you set yourself up for a good week that way.
Yes.
And thank you so much for doing that, because, you know, we're just a little show. You guys have been around so much longer than we have. So we really appreciate you you know, promoting us and talking about us on the show. So thanks, guys, for doing that.
Well, yeah.
And I got to tell you, I just pulled up the message from the last time I was on Pot of Thunder, and it was 5 years ago.
Wow.
October 19th, 2017.
Jeez.
Wow. And as I was leaving, so I had to get an Uber back to Chicago from, you guys are in, what's the name of the town?
Munster. Yeah. Munster, Indiana. Munster.
Yeah. So as I got my Uber and the guy's, you know, it comes up, the guy's name is Matthew, and I'm looking at my text to Chris here and it says, "Not so sure about Matthew. If you don't hear from me again, you know why."
Oh man.
So,
well,
I remember that.
The suspense is now resolved.
Yeah.
You made it.
Dangerous.
Yeah, so I got in the car with Matthew, and you know, when you order an Uber, you actually have to tell them where you're going. That's kind of how it works, right?
Yeah.
So I get in the car with Matthew and he's going, "Wait a minute. You're going all the way into Chicago?" Yes, that's what it says on the Uber that I ordered.
Yeah, because you have to accept as the driver, the ride, right? Like, it's like, hey, you're driving from point A to point B. Do you want to do this? Yes, I do. So before you even get to the rider, you know what you're doing because you've agreed to it.
Exactly.
Yeah.
Exactly. So, for some reason, Matthew wasn't too thrilled to take me back to my hotel. So that's why I sent that text. But thankfully, I talked to him the whole way so he didn't kill me.
And that's the secret.
Yeah, yeah, if you stopped talking, he would have reached in under his seat.
And well, okay.
This guy's not talking. I'm going to kill him.
Murderers are not known to be conversationalists. So if you confuse them with something they're not used to, you're good.
His mind was otherwise occupied.
Yeah, as soon as this guy's done.
Questions.
As soon as this guy's done, he's dead. Nope, never stop talking.
So earlier, as we were setting this up, or earlier today, you mentioned, well, you're in town for work, and you also mentioned that you had gone out for dinner with your coworkers tonight. Where'd you guys eat today?
So, you know, usually when someone from out of town comes to Chicago, I would expect that they would take me to some place that's, you know, somewhat Chicago style food. That would be the thing I would do. If you guys came to Atlanta, I would take you to a, you know, some kind of Southern cooking or Southern cuisine.
Yeah.
No, they took us to a place that I believe Chevy Chase owns. It's called Caddyshack.
Mm. You like that, huh?
Did not like that, James. Did not like that at all.
I never heard. I didn't know. I've never not heard of that here of you.
I think we drove past it because it's over like in the Rosemont area, like by the airport, right? It's close to.
Exactly. Yep, right by the Rosemont.
Yep.
Not good. Don't recommend it.
It was bad, huh? Bad meal. Is it just like, I'm not saying this is necessarily bad, but is it just like a Chili's or something that's themed as Caddyshack?
Exactly.
Yeah. Okay.
It's like what's the Buffett place, the Margaritaville, kind of like that.
Okay.
Oh boy.
It's probably the same thing. All right.
Except they if you come in with a certain hat, you get a free bowl of soup with it, or some, you know, some sort of shtick from the movie is probably fired at you. I had no idea that existed.
Yeah. Any place that has a theme, for the most part, you know, the food's crap.
That's true.
Yeah, because all they care about is the theme.
Yeah.
If the theme is not good food, then there's a problem.
Exactly.
So yeah, everything else cool with your trip? Everything good? Everyone behaving? Not running into any maniacs or anything?
No, everything is cool. Good. Always like coming to Chicago.
Yeah. I had a Nick-like experience today out in the wild, and I figured I'd share it with you guys. I went to a gas station here in town because I had a winning lottery ticket from months and months and months ago that my wife got from someone at work, a scratch off for $15. We had it forever. And I was finally like, I'm going to take this thing and cash it in. We're not big lottery people. So anyway, I didn't really know what I was doing. I go to the gas station. There's a guy in front of me doing the exact same thing. And the lady who's working there, she said, you have to scan your ticket. And then the machine will tell you if it's a winner or not. So the guy's like, okay. He scans his ticket and he's like, I don't see any, like, I don't, it doesn't say. And she, right away, this quickly into the conversation, sir, do the glasses you're wearing work?
Wow.
Jeez.
It's like, jeez. Yeah. And he said, well, yeah. And then, you know, a minute later, he's like, I'm sorry if I said something that offended you. So this lady was testy. It just seemed like something that would happen to Nick.
Wow.
Do your glasses work? So,
man, oh man.
Yeah. maniac.
Where was this?
It was at a gas station and here in Munster. Okay. At a Marathon gas station.
Man, oh man.
Yeah. Yeah.
People just don't care.
It's really not wise to engage somebody that way in this day and age.
No.
Because everybody's got a short fuse these days.
I was actually looking at the two, I would have put my money on the guy being the psycho, but I was wrong. He was actually a very nice-mannered, well-mannered man, behaved himself. She was a psycho.
The employee.
Yeah, the employee was a psycho.
There must not be anybody working.
No, that's
to be that fearless to a customer.
Maybe that's the advantage.
There must not be anybody wanting jobs right now.
That's like the champion's advantage of... Hey, no one else wants to work.
There's another possible scenario. There's another possible scenario. It could have been that she was interrupted, because if she works at a gas station, she may have been working on some yard questions for you guys.
Oh, man, that could have been it. She was two questions in, and this guy broke her concentration.
Yeah, interrupting the important business of the day.
All right, so more important business for the day. This chair is broken, by the way.
Is
Andy
it?
May yeah. go down at any point during the episode here.
Something happened. It's tipping forward on me. Oh, God.
Andy went down.
Down goes
what the fuck? You broke my office chair, man.
I sat on it. How did it break?
Oh, dear.
I don't know what happened.
You're going to get a pinched nerve from that, man.
Look at this.
Yikes.
I broke a weld in an office chair. My God, if there was ever a sign to take it easy with the Chick-fil-A, that was it. First podcast ever. From this position, I might like it.
Now I got to go buy a new office chair.
Now we got to have one of them. We have to pick one of the 1,000 songs out there with the lyric "Down on Your Knees."
Yep.
For this episode.
That's it.
Well, Kevin's standing up because he's apparently got a pinched nerve, so there's something going on.
Mm.
Meanwhile, Nick and I are comfortable.
Chris and I will be writing in style.
Yeah,
yeah, you will
throughout the duration.
Fuck.
Hey, you know, it's fun. I'm recording this, too, on video, so we could post my wipeout.
Christ.
All right, so important business. Chris said Kevin chose the song, like you mentioned earlier. Is there anything you want to say before we play the clip and you reveal to Nick and I what this week's song is?
Yes, so, you know, on our show, In Obscuria, what we do is we talk about rock, punk, and metal, but we do things that we consider either lost, forgotten, or should have been. So things that we think should have been bigger than they were.
Okay.
So what I've done is I've picked a band that had some success and a song. We're going to play a song that's probably their most successful song chart-wise, but it's a band that I feel like should have been a whole lot bigger. And it's a band that you guys have never played on the show before in his due time.
Exciting.
And I also feel it's a band that that I'm sure Andy and Nick are aware of. Just wheel it close to the trash can, because that's where it's going to end up. Just move it to the other side of the room.
I was hoping it would come apart and I could just sit on the seat on the
Jesus.
Floor. But no, it's not happening.
More money flying out of my pocket. Anyway.
I wonder if I get my feet on here.
But I'm sure Nick and Andy have at least heard of this band, and I would be surprised if they're not fans of this band. It would seem like it would be somewhat in their wheelhouses. Mm-hmm.
Can you give us a hint as to a time period?
So this particular song is from the early 90s, and this band, this was their most successful album.
Well, yeah. I have a guess in my head, so I'll let you know if I was even close afterwards.
Well, I'll give you one more hint. So this is from 1991, but it's not grunge.
Okay, that's in line with my guess.
I wonder if Nick's got it. I don't know. We'll let Kevin do the reveal, and just to remind you of the order with the Jericho intro. It's song title, album, artist, right, Andy?
That's correct. You ready?
See if I screw it up.
All right, let's do it. Let's screw something up. Let's screw something else
again.
Up.
Again.
Yeah.
All right, Harold. This one's called
Sunless Saturday.
Off of
The Reality of My Surroundings. Fishbone.
Oh. A little lag there,
yeah,
but...
A little lag, but yeah.
Okay, we got a Fishbone song.
Yeah, so it was, what, Sunless Saturday, correct?
That's correct.
Yes.
Was that your guess, Nick?
No, but it actually, my guess had the word fish in the band name.
What?
I thought we were getting a jellyfish song.
Oh, yeah. Okay. That would have been pretty good. But this is a good one. So what do you guys think, Jones boys, your thoughts on Fishbone?
I have a copy of In Your Face, I think it's their first album from 85, 87, 86.
Which is more ska.
Yeah.
So that was... Yeah,
which Andy's.
They started
Andy's
off being
ska.
More of a ska band.
Yeah,
right? And then they kind of migrated into funk, hard rock, metal. They mm-hmm. did it all.
Yeah, but even that one. I mean, I don't know. I didn't continue. I don't have all their stuff after that. I've heard some of it, but even on that one, there are elements of other styles of music. You know, like it's ska, but there's like, you know, slap bass and some. Digital like keyboard stuff that you wouldn't expect from ska. I don't know.
Yeah,
cutting edge for the time.
Well,
for sure.
For me,
yeah.
As a kid, they were of interest because in the movie Back to the Beach, they did the Jamaica ska with Annette Funicello fronting the band, if you will, for that
really?
Song. She sang the song and they played it.
Wow.
And I remember they were on the Last Action Hero soundtrack. I forgot the name of the song, but that was a pretty heavy
Swim.
One. Yeah.
That was called Swim.
Swim. And saw them, actually. Andy went with me. Mm-hmm. We saw them open for, it was them, STP, and the Chili Peppers in 99. And unfortunately, the venue where we were sitting, the sound was awful. Mm-hmm. So Fishbone sounded just like a bunch of noise. Would have been great to have better sound. But,
they were on that bill, huh?
Yeah.
They were first.
Interesting. Okay, yeah. So you've somewhat seen them, despite the sound. You've seen a Fishbone performance.
Yeah.
And they were supposed to be the opening band. When would that have been? Last September? When? Yeah, it was during the Riot Fest season, whatever, that week. They were supposed to be Mr. Bungle and Fishbone mm-hmm. at like a smaller club, like a midnight show one of those days.
And I got scuttled by COVID? Or
no, what? By Patton.
Oh, well.
Bailed on
same
the
whole thing.
Yeah.
COVID, Patton, equally detrimental.
Unforeseen circumstances.
Yep.
Yeah.
Yep. He just, well, he didn't do any of the shows. He hasn't been seen in 2 years or whatever. But yeah. Yep. So that was, I was actually really looking forward to that because, you know, like what Nick said, we saw them once and didn't get a great representation of what they sounded like as a live band. No. It was just an echoey mess.
Yeah.
I saw them for the first time at Lollapalooza 93, which was the one that it was, I believe, Primus and Alice in Chains. And they went on fair early. And then I saw them again in the late 90s. And they opened for 311. And at that was like the peak of the 311 thing. And it was all kids. And yeah. It was in the amphitheater. And I was the only one standing up for the entire Fishbone performance in the entire amphitheater. And I'm up there just going, all these kids around me have no idea who Fishbone are.
Did you leave early?
Like, I like 311 okay, but I'm
okay.
Like, you guys... You're hearing this music and you're not getting into this. I don't know what's wrong.
Yeah, and it's
again a band that should have been big, really.
Yeah, and I mean, I guess we'll get more into it, but a band which makes sense to play with 311, like a genre that they would fit into. Why none of the kids at the show would have been like, hey, you know, this is pretty cool too.
Well, I think Fishbone's a little more. Or a lot more high energy than 311. I mean, 311, they've got their moments, but they're just kind of like a, you know,
they're kind of
mellow,
yeah.
You know. You know, Fishbone is pretty, at least in their early days, maybe they mellowed out a bit, but But yeah, when Kevin
told me he was
yeah, well, good, because when Kevin was told me that he was going to pick Fishbone, I went through my past articles and from the college newspaper, and then article came out October 13th, 1988, and I'd interviewed the keyboardist, Chris Dowd, whose stage name is Charlie Down, apparently, when the Truth and Soul album came out, which was the previous album to this one, right, Kevin?
That's right, yeah.
Yeah, and when they came through campus, they played at a place called Rick's, where my band had ended up playing a few times. But, you know, tiny club, maybe 500 people in there, and they just friggin' bulldozed the joint. And for this article and this album, you know, they were promoting a show. They were playing at the Student Union, which was a larger venue, but still, you know, got pretty haywire in there. And
the Student Union at Michigan State.
Yep.
Okay.
Yep. In the Union Ballroom.
Okay.
So when he mentioned, I remembered I interviewed this guy, and he had a great quote here that's in the article I'm going to read to you, because again, the Truth and Soul definitely had a kind of a rock edge. And earlier that year, I had interviewed Vernon Reed, and, you know, it was kind of like, it was just seemed interesting to me that a lot of these black artists were coming out with a rock edge. And I asked the keyboardist about that, about whether, you know, white kids, white audiences, white radio stations would accept them. And he actually got a little salty. I remember that it says in here, it says, but Fishbone expresses more resentment than concern about the situation. Why does music have to have labels? Dowd asked. Why can't it just be music, just rock and roll? All labels do is fuck up the music. As long as it's good and it conveys a message, that should be good enough. And then this is where it got pretty good. As far as I'm concerned, great music overwhelms everything. It doesn't matter if you're orange. It doesn't matter if you're from another planet. It doesn't matter if your dick is 2 inches long. It's the music that counts. So yeah, that was pretty one of the many cool interviews I got to do when I worked for the student newspaper. But yeah, when those guys came into town, it's like I almost felt sorry for whoever owned the venue they played at, because it just got insane whenever they played. And and you know, that massive amount of energy coming off the stage just flowed into the crowd, and everybody just kind of went haywire. It was sort of a precursor for, you know, like Kevin mentioned, of what Lollapalooza would turn into, and what a lot of the rock scene would turn into would be more of that energetic, you know, slam dancing, mosh pit kind of action going on. So definitely ahead of their time, one of those bands that kind of paved the way for what would come a few years later.
Now, proving that I listened to your show, Chris, did you leave out on purpose? Did you leave out Jack Russell's name when you read that quote?
I believe so, yes. Jack Russell did not come up in the discussion.
This is a reference to his lyric from last week.
It doesn't matter if you have a small head, medium head, tiny head.
Yeah.
Music is music.
Yeah.
Get the thesaurus out.
Minuscule head.
See.
Puny head.
I'll listen. See.
All right. Well, are you guys ready to do this?
Yeah. I actually haven't listened to a lot of Fishbone in my day, so I'm curious.
And let me just say before we start, the reason I picked this song, so this was their biggest hit that they had chart-wise, and this is the first song that I ever heard of them, just being a little skate punk, but I never actually heard their music. And I heard this and then saw them on Saturday Night Live in 91 as well. So if you get a chance, go YouTube that performance, because it's amazing.
Who hosted that one? I know, that's a tough one.
That I don't remember.
I gotta look that up in the meantime.
Who would they pair with Fishbone?
I mean,
let's see, 91. Joey Buttafuoco might have been the host.
That's a good one. Yeah. Who could forget that episode? Saturday Night Live.
The Buttafuoco Fishbone episode.
But yeah, this video was definitely a staple of 120 minutes back in the day. I remember seeing it.
It's a Spike Jonze video. Do you know that?
Oh, really?
No, I did not know that. No,
it's an early one, huh?
Yep. It's and it, you know, it got some notoriety because of that. And
that would be early in his career, though, right? Wouldn't it be?
For Spike Jonze?
Yeah. He filmed out.
Yeah. All right.
It was before he was like really known.
Did I say Spike Jonze?
Yeah.
I'm such a moron. Spike Lee. Spike Lee.
Oh, Spike Lee. I was like, Spike Jonze, that would be really early, right? But okay.
This was Spike Lee. Spike Lee's, this is the height for Spike Lee.
Dumbass comment, sorry.
No, that makes a lot more sense. Now I get you. Okay. Yeah. I could see why that would be a built-in conversation. Oh, I got to see this band. Spike Lee did the video. Very cool. I'm looking this up.
Two spikes that I can pick from, and I picked the wrong one.
I'm looking this up. I need to know who the host was.
You're going to ruin it for me.
Why?
It's not going to live up to my guess, I don't think.
Well, we're going to find out. Well done. As I look, come on, Daily Motion. Oh, come. You suck. How do you not have the clip where the person introduces the band?
Oh, I've got it up here. I found it.
All right, well, give it to
us. Yeah, it's not Buttafuoco, I can assure you.
Oh, well. Who is it?
Interesting, though. Jeremy Irons was the host.
Wow, okay. Okay, what would it be? The Man in the Iron Mask or something? That era?
Gosh, I don't know.
March 23rd, 1991.
Mm. Jeremy Irons.
Somehow that works. That makes sense to me.
Makes perfect sense. All right. Well, are you guys ready?
Go ahead. Let's do it.
Oh, okay. Let's take a commercial break. I'm not ready.
I mean, yeah.
It's gonna be.
I hope it's for a chair.
It's gonna be for Office Depot.
Yeah. Well, it better not be for them because they sold me this chair. Although this chair has held up for several years.
I was gonna say, it's just going to be them laughing.
Fucking Andy comes in here, can't sit fucking still. He broke my office chair.
That's what happens. I don't know.
Yep, I'll be heading over to Staples tomorrow.
Yep. All right, let's see what advertiser we've got, and we'll be right back.
Wow. Kind of unexpected intro, because from what I think of Fishbone, I wouldn't think of like a super melodic acoustic guitar sort of section like that. Then what we just heard with it going over the top like that and kind of becoming dissonant with some of the heavy guitars added makes more sense. But I like that. I like the... I'm a fan of when people do that, when they set a certain mood in the intro and it doesn't, it's just kind of brief, and then it goes somewhere else completely. Kind of like, I think we talked about this before, but it would be sort of like a rock till you drop or something like that, where you think you're getting something from the intro and then it's just something completely different.
And one thing you'll notice is there's a lot of layers. Because Fishbone is a 7-piece band, right? So I remember when I first heard this song back in the day, every time I listened to it, I heard something different in the mix. So this is one of those you're going to want to go revisit because it's just so dense. There's so many different sounds in here.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, and then going back to what Nick said, it's like, you know, you hear that acoustic guitar and you know, like given the time period, well, actually this was more into the 90s, but you know, you almost get that, you know, Tesla, Little Susie vibe, yeah, or I Remember You, Skid Row vibe of like this acoustic intro, and you're like, you think you're gonna get something like that, and then they punch you in the face with,
yeah,
you know what Fishbone did. So yeah, definitely an off-putting intro, but it draws you in, and then it you know, cracks you right between the eyes. Pestilence outside my window. I see the dawn you started, leaves the mind. I see the shadows of sad dreams in the street. I face the morning with my customary sound.
I got some tuba happening, or some trombone back there.
I think that was a tuba.
Was it? Yeah, so
Yeah, they have horns, and they have this guy. You heard the background vocal. So there's this one guy named Dirty Walt, and he's like the big guy in the band, and he plays the smallest little trumpet. I don't know what you call this little trumpet, but it looks ridiculous because it's so tiny. He's
I think they call that Jack Russell trumpet.
Yes, it's the small head trumpet, I believe is what they call it. But anyway, all he does is he just dances, and he plays the trumpet every once in a while, and then he sings the background vocal.
Okay, it's a good job if you can get it.
Yeah, and I'm going to look up the personnel here, but the guitarist, I've got his name listed somewhere in this article. Let me find
Kendall Jones. Yeah,
Kendall Jones. He's on this album.
Yeah. So, do you know the story about Kendall Jones?
I was just about to bring up the story about Kendall Jones. I do know it. Tell the story to the Jones brothers. It's a very strange stuff.
What did cousin Kendall do?
Was it at the reunion?
Your cousin Kendall, so he's the original guitarist, and this album they brought on a second guitarist, which is, I think it's John Bigham was his name, and he was like with Miles Davis, so they brought in this guy to be a second guitarist, keyboardist, and that's, again, you get all these layers here. But what happened to Kendall Jones, and you're going to hear a fantastic guitar lead from him later in the song, but when they went to the next album, the one that that Nick, you said was, you heard the song Swim off of Last Action Hero. When they did the album that came out on, Kendall, I guess his dad was in some sort of cult, and he swayed Kendall Jones to think that everything he had done in his past, and especially Fishbone themselves, that they were all the devil. And so he basically goes AWOL from Fishbone, and the guys in the band, the Fish Brothers in Fishbone, they basically try to go abduct him to get him out of this cult and out of this scenario.
Wow.
And Norwood Fisher, who's the bass player, he ends up getting arrested because of attempted kidnapping.
Jeez.
So it was quite a story, but Kendall Jones never came back to Fishbone.
And that was it. Is he still with us, or?
He's still around. I believe he joined them for a single song in like 2020, but that was it.
Oh, okay. So maybe he's not locked up somewhere anymore. He's just...
Yeah, but he definitely had some mental issues that he had to deal
with. Yeah, and that was the big thing, is like the band went and tried to kidnap him and bring him back from like this cult, like, and a couple guys got arrested.
It's like an A-Team episode. I mean, that's
pretty much,
pretty out there. Yeah.
It's on video too. So they actually
have a
home video release in the 90s where they showed the whole thing of them trying to abduct him.
And like three or four guys in the band look like Mr. T anyway, so it all kind of goes together.
What are you saying, Andy?
Saying they have mohawks, Chris. Yeah. What are you hearing? What are you
don't
hearing?
Answer that.
Andy only sees hairstyles when he looks at people.
That's exactly it.
But that's kind of it's a crazy story and mildly amusing, but definitely a shame, because the guy was a hell of a guitar player and really brought that, you know, that rock, almost metal edge to the band, which I think appealed to a lot of people and you know, got them on bills with the likes of 311 and STP and Chili Peppers. You know, had that that rock edge that people liked, and he was pretty much responsible for it, kind of like it, you know, in the Rocky George vein. So it was kind of a bummer that he had those issues, because, you know, the world kind of, I mean, he didn't die, but the world lost a pretty potent guitar player there.
Oh, it's funny you bring up Rocky George because he was in Fishbone for quite a while in the 2000s as well.
Oh, that I didn't know that. Wow, interesting. Mm-hmm. Yeah, these guys all. It's almost like the you know the hair metal scene where everybody's in each other's bands eventually. So that's pretty interesting. But well, cool little you know bit of info, value add from Mr. Williams who knows. Pretty much everything about music. He's forgotten more than I'll ever know about it. If you've ever listened to the show, I mean, some of the bands and the songs that they dump out there, it's like it's almost like my stance on book reading. It's like, how the fuck do you have the time to find out about all these bands and then listen to all these bands? It's incredible. So
I don't have friends.
Well,
we don't either, but we don't know anything about music, right?
Right, exactly. We waste our time doing other things, but yeah, no, the encyclopedic knowledge of music that is not necessarily in the mainstream is quite impressive. So do yourselves a favor and check out InObscuria. Now, this comment will be a little bit pandering to Andy, which I don't know why I'm doing that. He destroyed my fucking office chair, which is, you know, I'm going to be at least $50 lighter tomorrow. Although this gives me an opportunity to, you know, get one of those fucking buku office
chairs. Executive chairs.
The problem is, what I liked about that chair, which is going in the garbage right after we get done because it's completely destroyed.
See it spinning back there.
Is it doesn't have any armrests on it, so I can also use it not only for my desk, but I can sit and play guitar on it.
Yeah,
with nothing
right.
blocking my arm. So I'd like to find something a little more high quality than this, but that doesn't have. You know, the armrests, I don't really need that. But anyway.
You can probably just not put the arms on, too, on a lot of chairs.
Well, it's like you know, if I don't assemble it correctly, the next time your ass sits down on it, you're going to fucking break it. And I don't want that to happen either.
That's true.
Ideally, I would find something that doesn't have any restrictive arm mechanism on it. But anyway, I'm going to pander to Andy a little bit here. But hearing any resemblance to Faith No More or any of Patton's bands and some of the approach here?
I hear it in, that's Angelo, the singer, right? Angelo Moore? Or is this not right. Angelo singing? Yeah, it is?
Yeah,
okay,
it's
Angelo. Yeah. I hear it in his voice, like in the Real Thing album, the early Patton before he changed his voice, and first Mr. Bungle album. So
that's got to be appealing to you,
yeah,
correct?
Yeah, yeah, yeah. Definitely.
I think the bass tones are really similar too. I think what Roddy Bottom was doing is very similar what Wood Fisher had going on as far as those tones.
For bass tones or Billy?
Yep.
Billy on the bass Roddy's the keyboard.
Sorry. See, there I go again.
Yep.
Mixing up my guys.
That's all right. But yeah, keyboard too. A lot of sustaining strings. No, these aren't really strings, more like an organ in this song, but yeah. All right.
Yeah, and this gives me the opportunity to say once again that when I worked the Hard Rock, one of the managers there was a close friend of Roddy Bottom's, would speak of him often. So whenever Roddy Bottom is mentioned on the show, which is more than occasionally.
It is quite often.
I mention that, and then I'm never shy about mentioning that I went to high school with John Five's sister and tell that story about the Battle of the Bands. So I will always do that whenever either of those guys is mentioned.
All right, let's keep it going.
So again, notice the layers there and the vocals, especially because you got, so Chris Dowd, who you interviewed, Chris, he he's an excellent singer as well. In fact, their song Everyday Sunshine, he, I think, was the main lead singer on that song. But you've got so many vocal harmonies going on, and these guys pull it off live. You hear all these layers and you think, okay, they can't replicate this. They replicate it every time they play. I mean, just talk about fantastic musicians.
Oh yeah, there's definitely no doubt about that. When you whether you're hearing them for the first time or you're hearing them, you know, every note they've ever played, there can be no question about the level of musicianship. And also, you know, especially as we're hearing here, that just that intense energy that especially in those early days, those gigs they played on the college campus and these relatively smaller venues were just flat out insane. And you know, again, set the table for what was going to come in the 90s, where that just kind of the whole, you know, alternative rock Lollapalooza scene, that just kind of became the norm at most concerts. You know, just people, a lot more of that kind of energy happening in with bands and venues.
So, and it's not often you see a keyboard player who's actually dancing on stage, and he's not playing a guitar. He had his keyboard was on this kind of swivel stand, so he could like kind of move around and spin it around. And
that's cool.
And he was kind of dancing on stage and singing and playing at the same time.
Since copied by the new guy in Styx, whose keyboard is on a swivel, although he's slightly less energetic than the guys in Fishbone, but that's kind of his thing. He's got the one keyboard on a swivel, kind of like my busted up office chair over there.
God forbid.
Don't let Andy near that swivel, or they're going to have a problem.
I'll put my elbow on it and
yeah.
End of the gig. You were mentioning how
this is an expensive episode.
It is. Fishbone, were they known as like road warriors back then? Like they would just play anywhere? Is that kind of the reputation of Fishbone?
Well,
very much so.
Constantly on the road.
Well, they definitely, again, the back in the day, you know, before the Lollapalooza generation or whatever, you know, bands like this played every college town they could, because that's where they were going to be people who had actually either heard of them or were open to seeing something totally new and getting involved in these crazy, wild concert scenes.
A lot of young people in one place with nothing else to do but go crazy.
Well, yeah, but you know, still playing smaller venues, but they would pack the place with people who had, again, had either heard of them or heard of what went on at one of their shows. And you know, back in the day, that's where alternative rock really got its traction, was in college campuses and college radio stations and stuff like that. So you know, this was you know, again, they played the bar just off campus where all the bands played, and then the next time through they played at the Union Ballroom, which was a bigger venue but still not like the size of the MSU auditorium, and packed the place, and it was crazy. So I would imagine they hit all the colleges they could you know, before really you know, hitting the big time, appearing on SNL and being on Lollapalooza and all that.
Now, what year was that, Chris, that they played State?
Well, this was this show was for the Truth and Soul album, so it would have been October 88, and then maybe a year or two prior is when they played the smaller club that was just off campus. So they'd been at it for a few years by that point.
So in 87, they were the opening band on the Beastie Boys' License to Ill tour.
That's cool.
Oh, wow. Gee, okay. All right, that explains it. It explains, you know, that they were somewhat known, and you know, whenever they came through town, their shows were always packed. So yeah, that's a pretty good that's a pretty good slot, I would say.
Now, when did they first start releasing albums? Was it like early '80s? Because I'm trying to think of like what ska wave. would that have been?
I think that
that second wave.
Yep. Second wave, 85, I believe.
Okay.
Second wave, but kind of doesn't sound like it, right?
A little later.
They don't sound like Madness or
no. That's specials. Yeah. That's kind of what I was.
Well, second, like if you think about second wave ska, most of it's English. So
yeah.
So
like English beat or something like that.
Yeah. So they were U.S. kind of mimicking second wave.
Yeah. So it's kind of its own thing, and whatever else, whatever I'm guessing, whatever backgrounds they came from as far as what they were playing, because on that first album, there's already elements of other stuff. The reason I asked that question about the traveling thing, being a road band, was because leading up to that show that got canceled, there was some thing trying to, you know, like a publicity press release thing. And Mr. Bungle was talking about how the only bands that ever came to the town where they were from were Fishbone and Faith No More when they were college age. Mm. And then they, you know, became friends with both of them and remained friends with both of them. But no other bands ever came through, so I guess Fishbone was just up for whatever. It's kind of, that was the impression that I got from that article.
Okay. That, I mean, like a King's X or even Ramones style of thing.
Yeah. Just bands. Hit the road.
Or Motorhead. Yeah. Bands known for always being on the road.
Yeah.
Yep. Yeah. And this is their third album, In Your Face. First studio album, 86. Truth and Soul, 88. And then Reality of My Surroundings, 91.
Hmm. All right, let's keep going.
I'm kind of zeroing in on the drums. Mm-hmm. I mean, they're very prominent.
Yeah.
Yeah.
This is a drum heavy song. But the playing, it really, to me, sounds like you'd have a hot shot at Guitar Center, like a guy who really is showing off. And I'm not saying that in a derogatory way at all, but like someone who can really play and who's kind of like doing little how would you say it, inversions on the beats every once in a while and stuff like that, really tight sort of playing. Mm-hmm. that's kind of what I'm getting.
Yeah, having worked there, I would say that's pretty accurate, you know, from the old Saturday at Guitar Center. Everybody, you get these people who'd come in every once in a while and drop their stun guitar, bass, or drum licks on everyone, and occasionally you'd get a legit player in there, and it's actually pretty accurate.
Yeah, and the drummer's Fish. They just called him Fish, but he's the brother of the bass player, so you have two brothers in the band. And he actually, more recently, he's played with a band called 24/7 Spies, who you guys haven't played yet either, but I think I've submitted a few other songs, so you might get some.
All right. Bass player, you said he's the brother of the drummer. Is he, you as a bass player, is he playing a fretless bass on this song? Sounded like some.
I'll be honest, I'm not sure, but I think you're right, because he always has this, I don't know how he gets that tone.
Yeah.
But he's got this real funk style of slap playing, and he does a lot of slides. And all of his slides, to me, like you said, it kind of sounds like fretless bass.
Mm-hmm.
So I'm not sure, but he was one of the first guys that I saw having that really low, you know, played the five string and had that really low tone.
Yeah, right.
Yeah. Okay. Yeah, there's that part there where he seemingly out of nowhere, like he double timed what he was doing on the bass and then did a couple of crazy slides for, I liked it, but you know, I don't think he did it previously and he probably won't do it again. He's just going off on one part.
And it's probably a live performance, music, I'm thinking instrumentally in the studio.
Probably,
it's probably right. they're letting loose, and everybody kind of is has free rein to goof around with it and see what works.
And it would be hard to it would be pretty difficult to capture this level of energy just from a pieced together type of music. I mean, it's to some extent these guys were together banging out the the core tracks of this, I would imagine, and not just piecing everything together separately.
Yeah, and Norwood, so the bass player is Norwood Fisher, and so him, Angelo Moore, the singer, and Dirty Walt are kind of the mainstays in the band throughout time. Mm-hmm. So it's really the bass player in the singer's band for the most part, and Dirty Walt as well. But again, he just plays the little tiny Jack Russell trumpet.
I tell you, bands that have the more or less mascot guy on stage, it tends to work.
Yeah.
Like Boss Tones.
Yeah. Boss Tones, Bus Boys.
311 have that little guy. Who occasionally he'll like put his finger on a keyboard, but other than that, he just kind of fucking dances around like one of the druids in Spinal Tap, you know? It's like, why is this fucking guy in the band?
I don't know much about 311. I didn't know they had some little guy dancing.
Yeah, and I mean, he'll trade off vocals with Hexum, but other than that.
Oh, is he the guy who does, like on their big song, who does the rap part?
Yeah, he's got like that high,
so he's got some lead,
nasally voice.
He's kind of like like a Joe C kind of.
He's the Joe C of 311.
Okay, yeah.
Okay, so, but he's got like main parts. He's just not.
Right. When you see him on stage, he definitely comes off to me as more of a mascot. You know, okay. Everybody else is, you know, got an instrument strapped on, and he's just like dancing around, barks out a vocal here and there.
I'm telling you, that's the gig to get. Yeah. Probably doesn't carry anything.
I mean, and it lends itself to.
He's not hauling an amp in.
No, he's not.
He's not setting up the drums.
That's why he's still in the band. He hasn't hurt himself.
Yeah.
He hasn't put strain on himself.
Yeah.
So as far as that prestigious group of fretless bass players, there's a new addition to that group.
That's right.
The Mount Rushmore of fretless bass players. They have to get the dynamite out and blast Andy's face on the side of the mountain now.
That's right. I bought a fretless ukulele bass on Amazon. I got it yesterday.
What?
It's pretty awesome.
Ukulele bass.
Yeah.
What the fuck is that?
And it plugs in electric, too.
Yeah, Andy sent me a video of him jamming on it.
Yeah.
What is a ukulele bass?
I don't know. It's just it's a tiny bass. And I'm treating it as...
Jack Russell bass.
Exactly. You know, right? I'm treating it as something you just leave on the couch instead of something you put away and take it, you know.
Okay, yeah. But I'm seeing a similar...
Got the frets
instruments on here, yeah.
The frets noted on there, but they're
but
right,
it's
the fret lines. It's
yeah,
yeah. Well, that's great, Andy. However much that costs you is probably what I'm going to spend on a fucking office chair. And those bass noises you were making a minute ago, I think that's the noises my chair was making just before it broke off under you and sent you to the floor. So yeah. It's all coming together.
The
here.
Stem of that chair almost went up my butthole and made that noise.
After which you'd have made another noise.
Yeah, a little higher register.
Yeah, you'd have made a noise similar to the mascot in 311. High-pitched, nasally. Yeah.
All right. Let's keep going.
I'm thinking we go kidnap this guy right now.
We need him back?
Yeah, we want him here.
Yeah.
That was pretty great.
Yeah, he was great, man. He, you know, played like the metal guitars of the day, like either a Jackson or an ESP, locking tremolo. He was doing all the kind of, you know, hair metal tricks, but in a more adventurous way, not quite as out there as Vernon Reed, but definitely in that vein. Mm-hmm. And that's why it was so shocking when you read that story. It's like, fuck, man, this guy was kick ass, and how could this have happened to him? It's like you think you're in a great band like this, and you figure you'd be you know, insulated from any kind of nonsense. But I guess when it comes from your own father, it can, you know, be different. Oh, but yeah, it was that. What a weird story that is.
I just Googled Kendall Jones because I wanted to just put a visual with this guy. Mm-hmm. Don't Google Kendall Jones and look at the images. No, it's no. One of these people, these women who shoot big game and take pictures with them. That's all it is, a bunch of pictures of dead cheetahs and stuff. So if you're curious,
yeah, no,
don't
thanks.
Do that. Type in Fishbone, too.
Well, I'm thinking we go pick up Kevin.
Mm-hmm.
Andy and Chris already have disguises, but more on that later. There are disguises in this room for them.
Yeah, that's for maybe next week or so.
Well, ideally, we get the Uber driver from 5 years ago, because this guy sounds like he'd be up to the task to go kidnap somebody.
He probably has a record already.
Yeah.
Hopefully it's not his third strike. He might be a little reluctant.
You could probably put in a request for him, assuming he's still alive.
I'm looking up Matthew right now.
Be like, wait.
Oh, no, don't look at the Google images.
It's imposing with dead animals.
He'd pull up and go, wait a minute, you're going into Chicago? It's like, yeah, but we're going to kidnap somebody. Oh, cool. I'm in. Oh,
this right. One's on me.
I'm all about that.
Turned off the fair thing.
Yeah, I'm off the clock. This one's on the house. It's a pro bono kidnapping.
So that's your boy Chris Dowd. The guy was really, really good, and he was an integral part of Fishbone, and he only lasted one more album, unfortunately. So to me, they lost a little steam once you had Kendall Jones gone and then Chris Dowd left, even though down the road they got Rocky George to play guitar. But John Bigham, who was the guy they brought in for this album, I saw them without Kendall Jones, and they just didn't have quite the same appeal as they did when he was the guitarist. So I think we do need to go get him right now.
Yeah.
Yeah, I mean, I'm already registering for Uber right now.
Well, we talked about this a little bit on the Alice in Chains episode, where I think Kendall Jones was more than just a bit player in the band, but like Kevin said, it was Angelo and the Fisher Brothers band, really. But when you take one of the ancillary guys out and it just changes the dynamic, it's definitely impacts the band, not necessarily in a good way.
Well, in a band like this, where everybody seems to be an excessively aggressive player,
mm-hmm.
So it's got to be hard to find someone. I mean, you'll have to find someone who can play the songs well enough, but much more, you gotta find a guy who's gonna be able to play it with the energy that lives up to the other guys in the band.
Interestingly enough, I'm on here in Wikipedia. Kevin mentioned that Kendall Jones came back November 2020 to join the band on stage for the first time since 1993 to play a song. That song was a cover of Them Bones by Alice in Chains for a tribute to the band arranged by the Museum of Pop Culture. I wonder if that's on YouTube. That's got
to
be good.
I was just thinking I need a recording of that.
Yeah, that's got to be good. Yeah, and the other thing on Wikipedia here, it's listing Christopher Dowd as a current member. Did he come back into the band at some point?
Yeah, I think they got the whole band without Kendall Jones back together like right before COVID, and they were supposed to do, I think, a tour with the original band, and I'm not sure whatever happened with that, if that's the band that's still exist today. I don't know.
Mm-hmm. Okay. Got it.
So while he's doing all this kind of ad-lib stuff, Angelo singing, at Lollapalooza, at least the show that I saw in Charlotte, Angelo decided that he wanted to go crowd surfing, which at Lollapalooza, I'm not sure that makes the best sense, but, you know, it's a rather large crowd. So he decides to go out, and I think he forgets that the size of the crowd and the distance from the stage, that his microphone is probably not going to work that well.
Yeah.
So at one point, he's doing all this ad-lib stuff as they're finishing up the song, and you just can't hear him. It just goes out. And Dirty Walt stands at the front of the stage with his little trumpet and his microphone and says, "Angelo, turn your shit on! Angelo, turn your shit on!"
Where's my shit?
Why do I remember that?
Did it help? Did he turn his shit on? Or was
I don't
it like
that was the problem.
Yeah,
it was out of range.
It was out of range, or was it even wireless? It might have just been.
Did he have to ask
unplugged?
The crowd to give him back, basically?
Yeah, send him back to the stage.
Reminiscent of Flying Air and before their famous set at Champs Rock Room, where he came on stage and just goes, "Where's my shit?" Asking where his microphone is, and
that's your shit, yeah,
just started off the mayhem that would ensue.
Where's my shit? I guess that's the singer's gear is the shit. Where's my shit? Turn on your shit.
Turn on your shit.
Yeah. All right. A little bit more, guys.
Jack Russell trumpet going on.
That was the Jack Russell trumpet at the end there.
That was it. That's cool. I like adding the trumpet into that.
Yeah.
Guitar part from the beginning. Nice. Oh, what are you thinking, Nick?
Woo. Well, should I? No, I think Kevin should vote first, right?
Should Kevin vote first?
Yeah. That's tradition.
Is it? Okay.
Yeah, well, whoever brought the song to the table.
Well, Kevin, do you want to pick Sweet Surrender or Kick in the Crotch? I have a feeling I know, but you tell us.
Sweet Surrender, for sure.
It's Sweet Surrender! Hell yes!
So, you know, this band, this was my introduction to the band, and this song has just always stuck with me. It's not exactly how they sound on every song, because like I said, they play all sorts of styles, from ska to funk to rock. But this band kind of put me on the trajectory, because as I went to college and started playing guitar and having my own bands, I ended up in a funk band for quite a while. And this band was just hugely influential on me and opened my eyes up to, you know, I knew Living Color, but they opened my eyes up to so many other bands like 24/7 Spies and just so many other funk bands, and the mix of rock, heavy rock and funk music, just, you know, something that meant a lot to me at that time. And yeah, just totally dig this band.
Nick?
A Sweet Surrender.
Ooh.
It's Sweet Surrender. Hell yes.
This is a song, and Kevin touched on this toward the beginning of it, that there's so much going on that I don't feel like I had a grasp on it completely, so I will be going back and listening to it several more times. And I'm looking, for whatever reason, I was looking, I'm like, you know what? I don't own the soundtrack to Back to the Beach. Mm-hmm. For some reason, I feel like I want to get it.
You need it.
It's got Jamaica Ska, Funicello and Fishbone officially listed. Pipeline with Stevie Ray Vaughan and Dick Dale. I remember that from...
That's cool.
Surfing, oh, wow. Surfing Bird with Pee Wee Herman.
Jeez.
Wipeout with Herbie Hancock, Dweezil Zappa, and Terry Bozzio.
My goodness.
So...
Yeah, you need to get
this
that.
This is truly something.
They put the soundtrack together first, it sounds like. Like, I guess we need a movie.
So, yeah, I guess I didn't really know much about Fishbone. I still don't, but really enjoyed especially the musicianship, just like extreme high energy from everybody.
Mm-hmm.
And... didn't know that they had a reputation for being like, you know, like these awesome musicians, this awesome collection of musicians. I kind of thought of them more as like sort of like Chili Peppers, where they were good, competent musicians. But these guys are on the next level from what I'm hearing.
So, oh, yeah.
So it's, yeah, it's kind of, it's piqued my interest to check them out a bit more, especially the fact that they started out as essentially a ska band, and to kind of hear that evolution would be interesting. So yeah, cool.
The other thing I failed to mention, so I'll give you a little more knowledge about Fishbone, is they so they all grew up together and they formed Fishbone in 1979. These guys were, so when we talked earlier about some of the guys leaving definitely impacted them musically, these guys were all buddies and they grew up doing this together in like high school band and all that. So
sure,
you know, when you have a bond like that and somebody leaves, that's, it definitely impacts the music a little bit.
Chris.
Oh, Sweet Surrender for me.
It's Sweet Surrender. Hell yes.
What the hell? Did something else happen? What was that noise?
I was just drumming.
Oh, okay. There it is. All right. I thought you broke something else in here. I was going to have to replace.
That desk is a goner.
Jesus Christ. Better not be. That desk is an iconic artifact for reasons we can discuss some other time. But yeah, no, going back to, like I said, college, when I was on the college newspaper, we get all these stacks of albums that, you know, would go through them, and half the bands I hadn't heard of before and probably should have investigated further, but one... You know, Truth and Soul was in the stack one day, and I remember that another guy I worked with would steal all the albums he wanted, and he was the guy who stole the Living Color album, and then brought it back the next day and said, "You have got to listen to this; you're gonna love it." And he was right. He did the same thing with Truth and Soul; brought it back. He's like, "You know what? I think you'll like this too," and he was right. And then the label called up because they were. Fishbone was coming through campus and was like, "Do you want to interview one of the guys in Fishbone?" I'm like, "Hell yeah!" And ended up seeing their show at the ballroom, and so I've definitely had a, you know, for sentimental reasons, you know, this band appeared on my radar and was just something that brings back good memories for me, and then. You know, the SNL thing and, you know, the weird story about Kendall Jones and stuff and seeing him on, I didn't see the Lollapalooza show, but I noticed them on the lineup. And, you know, again, for all those reasons, just a band that, that always had a, you know, a soft spot for me from a sentimental standpoint, but, you know, the energy in this recording is undeniable, and you know that, you know, kick-ass guitar solo and the whole arrangement, and like Kevin said, the production, there's just a bunch of stuff going on that you know, warrants repeated listening, and you know, all of that adds up to some pretty quality stuff, no question about it.
I too will give it a Sweet Surrender.
It's Sweet Surrender.
Man, a lot to say. It's almost intimidating listening to this because you feel how much better the musicians are than anybody like the bands you were in. You're like, geez, guys, take it easy. But yeah, very cool. I don't think I've ever heard this song before. I think somehow I missed it, even though you said it was the most popular Fishbone song. I don't know. I guess I was just, the TV was off when this one was on. I missed it. But very cool. Like to listen to more. Never really heard much after the first album, which is good. But, you know, it's just one of those bands where you have the one album and that's it for some reason. But I'm going to dig deeper this week. So,
yeah, I thought it seemed to me that Everyday Sunshine was a bigger hit than this one, just in terms of I think Everyday Sunshine is the one I remember seeing on 120 Minutes. I'm not sure I ever saw the video, the Spike Lee video for this one.
Or Spike Jones, if you're me and get it wrong.
Well, yeah.
Yeah, so in at the SNL performance, they always do two songs. So Everyday Sunshine was the second performance, which is also fantastic. Go check out, if anybody listening just wants to know, what are you guys talking about when you talk about energy? Just go look at that SNL performance, watch both of those songs.
Yeah, yeah, absolutely. You know, and that was right around the time when they actually had Skid Row on there doing Monkey Business and something else off the Slave to the Grind video. So it was definitely a good era for musical acts on SNL. Nowadays, my old ass fast forwards through all the music guests when I watch on DVR because I have no idea who they are. And even if I do find out who they are, it's just the pop tarts of the day, and I just don't understand how that's suddenly become cool and to be featured on SNL, which used to be a subversive show. But you know, I'm definitely sounding like an old guy now.
I just think it's not though, right? Huh? It's not a subversive show.
Well, it's not anymore. No. Certainly from a musical standpoint. I mean, it's just like I don't know how all that shifted. And you know,
you know what I miss is back in the day when any band would play on SNL, they used the set that was there. You know, you had that old fan kind of going in the back that
Mike Patton went into. Yeah.
Yeah. But, you know, every band had the same look. Now, when you see the bands on SNL, they actually bring their set. So
do they really?
Like they're on any stage. Yeah.
Yeah, they bring their set and half the skits are pre-recorded production pieces. It's a different show. I still enjoy it. I mean, I'm not one of these dickheads who's constantly like, it sucked since 75. Well, that's not true.
That's okay. When it started.
Yeah, right, exactly. You know, everything since the first episode has been shit, blah, blah, blah. You know, that's not true, but you know, certainly from a musical standpoint, you would not see a band akin to Fishbone on SNL anytime soon, if ever again. And yeah, those performances are definitely worth watching. I looked it up. The Them Bones cover is on YouTube, so check that out as well.
What, you know what? I'm trying to find this. Fishbone seems like a band that would have been on, and I can't think of the name of it, but I think they did it from it might have been Studio 8H. It was like 80s, maybe into the 90s. It was sort of like more eclectic music. Oh man, I can't remember what the name of it was though. I know, like,
I think a Night Flight,
maybe like the Pixies were on it at one point. Chili Peppers were on it. I think it was maybe when I don't know if Hillel Slovak was still around.
Hey, speaking
Night
of Chili
Music,
Peppers,
Night Music, I think it was called.
What's that song on Mother's Milk where they name check Fishbone in the song?
Oh, it's
Good Time Boys.
Yeah,
yeah, yeah. And they actually play a snippet of Bone in the Boneyard.
Yeah, exactly right. And they name check Fishbone, Firehose, you know, a bunch of other. Who is for that little section of the snippets where they do Bone in the Boneyard? What's the song where he goes, "She's a white girl"?
That's X.
Is it X?
Yeah.
Okay, I didn't know that. That's
like
hilarious.
That always
cracks me up when I hear that. I just that song came up on shuffle for me within the past couple of days. That always cracks me up, and I never knew where that song, where that came from.
That's
I'm pretty sure that's X.
The only other song I can think of that does that is I'm the Man, where it's got the Master of Puppets snippet.
Yeah. All right, well, so is it Night Flight or Night?
It was Night Music.
Night Music. Terrible name.
Yeah, Music. I think it was just more of a, it was more of just like a musician kind of a thing where they let these bands that had a cult following but weren't mainstream. And
And it was an NBC thing or not?
I think so.
Yeah,
I'm looking it up. But
like
I'm
after Saturday Night Live thing or something.
Maybe.
Was
that? Byron Allen the host of it?
Music Unleashed.
You know, Byron Allen has become quite a successful individual.
Oh, he's very
David Sanborn.
He's very wealthy.
I was going to ask if that was the Sanborn show.
It was Sanborn.
Yeah.
Looked like it was only on for a couple of years, but they had Sonic Youth. Slim Gaylord, Thelonious Monk, clips of him. He wasn't around anymore.
I was going
to
say.
I'm trying to see.
That had to be pretty cool,
Marcus
though.
Miller, not Mueller. I don't have my glasses on.
So it was a head drum solo. Drum solo with no sticks.
It was Wipeout. But yeah, I recommend people checking out some clips on there and just looking at the musicians who were on it. It's pretty crazy. I'm checking it out right now.
All right, well, we will do that, but we have business to attend to, Nick.
What?
All right, Hammond! I got a question for you.
Paul Stanley wants to know. He's got to know. What is this, 91 you said? Oh, yeah. Is Sunless Saturday a rock and roll boner classic? As voted by the four boners on today's program. Let's think about it.
My vote's in.
Chris's vote is in.
I'm good.
Oh, Kevin's good.
Ashford and Simpson were on it. Oh, wait. Oh. I got to be thinking of my vote.
That's solid as a rock.
Yes, it was.
Good stuff.
My vote's in.
All right. My vote's in. What's the order, guys?
I think Kevin should go first because we probably know how he's going to vote. I'll go second. Andy, Nick, or...
Sure. I'll go last. If it makes it there.
So, again, if it's your first time listening, where you been? But it has to be unanimous. It has to be rock and roll boner in that order. So, Kevin, we turn it over to you to get this voting round started.
All right. Rock.
And
roll boner.
And again!
Yeah, you can't deny the musicianship and the energy and just
production. It's all on point.
And
as we've alluded to, what an underrated, underappreciated band. I mean, just incredible stuff from them, and certainly the first few albums consistently good quality. So
yeah, first four especially, if you're gonna go check them out, first four albums amazing.
Are you someone who's listened to everything they put out as it comes out over time?
Of course.
What do you think of their more recent stuff?
Well, they haven't really put out anything in a while. They've had a couple of EPs. They've just been okay. They did have an album with Rocky George on it. It was called Still Stuck in My Throat, which was pretty good. Okay. That was probably the last decent album they put out that I consider really good.
How long ago was that?
Has to be 2010, somewhere around there.
Okay. So it's been a while. I remember for some reason, I don't know why I remember this, no one else heard it but me, the Ugly Kid Joe reunion EP, one of the songs featured Angelo Moore on vocals and horn. I forgot. I'm guessing it's a saxophone. I can't remember what it even sounds like, but I just remember thinking that was odd.
That's weird.
But cool. Yeah.
Unexpected. 2006 is when that last one came out.
Oh, okay. So, yeah. This would have been like a few years later. So they haven't done much. This, you said they've done some EPs since then, but that's...
They've had some EPs, some live stuff, but not a full length.
Not a full length. Well, guys, if you disagree, we're sorry.
That's just the fucking way it is.
Deal with it. Call my school. Tell them I'm dead. Or I died. That's what Nick's shirt says.
Yeah.
It says, call my school. Tell them I died.
I died.
And has Garfield on the beach with a surfboard.
Andy got me this shirt.
So there you go. Let's take a quick commercial break, and we'll be right back with Nick's favorite part of the show.
Commercials.
Yes, commercials. Ah, I love those commercials. They take me back. Those old-time commercials.
Oh, man.
I could listen to those all day. But unfortunately, we've got more show. So let's keep it rolling.
I don't get yards of questions.
Motherfucker, I give them.
Send away.
Yes, chief.
Yes.
I forgot to sound the alarm for more yards. Have we gotten any more submissions?
We got one a couple days ago. I'm going to use this one.
All right, I got to sound that alarm, though. We're running low, right?
Yeah, I mean, there's a bunch of unused ones, but
they're
a lot of
shit.
Them are, well, either they're shit. Some are just flat-out shit. Sorry, guys and gals. But a lot of them have repeat questions, which I get. You know, it's hard after doing so many to not ask some of the same questions, but it kind of ruins the whole yard when there's one, sometimes two questions that we've already been asked.
I mean, you could cobble them together, but that takes some work, and who wants to do that?
I might do that for the future, but hey, if you've got some questions on your mind, send them our way.
And he wants to spend as little time as possible because he's got nothing to sit on right now.
Yeah. Exactly.
He's gonna have a pinched nerve in his knee in a minute.
Yeah, I'm gonna ask three yes or no questions. Get the hell out of here. Okay, so this week's Yardo Questions comes to us from our pal Craig Binns.
Alright.
What up, Craig?
Hello, Craig.
Alright, Craig says, he gets right to it. Question one. Have any of you guys started listening to a new band through hearing a previously unheard song on your podcast? I did with your Styx Mr. Roboto show. Now loving their back catalog.
I don't know what he's talking about.
did we do a
Mr.? We did not. He's got to be joking. I don't know.
Whoops, wrong podcast.
Yeah.
I was thinking.
Someone really knocked it out of the park with their Mr. Roboto episode, though.
Binns is taking too many blows to the head, I think. It simply didn't happen. Although that wouldn't be a bad episode.
No. I was thinking, man, I have no recollection of that. I don't think I'm at that point where I don't remember whole episodes, but maybe today's the day.
I assumed it was real, and then maybe it was 3 years ago when I wasn't here.
Oh, well, it could have been. It could have been.
Well, I can assure you that did not happen.
Yeah. But a very interesting question.
Yeah. For sure.
Yeah, I mean, first one that comes to mind is... Crazy Horses by the Osmonds.
Mm. So you investigated more Osmonds from there, or you just like that song?
That album and the one after it, The Plan, I acquired and enjoyed.
Oh, okay.
So, I mean, I didn't go deep, but checked out a couple albums, liked it. There's more than a handful of songs I think are pretty great on those.
All right, I'll go. Let me find it. I'm gonna skip songs from February and mainly Februaries, so as not to piss off our racist listeners out there. They know who they are. They got all bent out of shape about the whole theme because they're fucking racists. So I'm just, why I'm pandering them, I have no idea, but I'm going to. Where the fuck is, let me find it.
I've got several if you need me to kill a little time.
I think you're going to take one of mine, so let me find this first. The fuck is it, man? Damn.
Tell you which one it wasn't. It was the Are You Ready for Freddy? From
no, yeah. I like me some Fat Boys. That was not...
That was an unfortunate representation of their catalog.
Yeah. Fuck. Hold on. I'm going to find it in a second. Just give me a second. But I think...
I got two.
Kevin's got two. Let's...
Now, okay. Before you go, Kevin, though, are you going to talk about what you've heard on our podcast or what you've heard on your show?
No, on Pod of Thunder.
Okay. All right.
There's two that I can call out right now. One being Street Heart.
That's what I was trying to find. And I hate giving Jericho any credit, that's for sure. But that Under My Thumb cover was outstanding. Then you delve back into the catalog, all pretty quality stuff. So.
Yeah.
Yeah, I went and bought the live album, so if you haven't heard that, it's really, really good. And, you know, I don't give Jericho the credit. I think it's all for Daryl, really. Daryl gets the credit.
Yeah.
Daryl's the Team Daryl, yes. Yeah, we're all on. Sure.
Yeah. The second one that I have is more recent. I actually went out and bought Billy Ocean after I heard them. Not that I hadn't heard that song a million times, you know, or heard Billy Ocean a million times, but I had never bought any music. And after the episode, I'm like, I'm going to go buy that album. So much fun.
Awesome. Chris, was that your one?
Yeah, okay. I'm thinking that's the one. I said, I have others, but they're from February, and I don't want to anger the racists out there, so I'm not going to say anything. It definitely is not Dropkick Murphys, though, I can assure you of that. So, yeah, what about you?
Mr.
Roboto. Yeah. I don't know what Bins is smoking, but yeah, he's way off on that. What do you got, Andy?
I was going to say Street Heart, too. That was the one I was thinking of. I don't know. I'll think of something.
I liked the King's X Over My Head.
Yeah.
That one I added to my playlist right away.
But have you gotten really into a lot of their other stuff?
I guess not.
That's what I'm interpreting this question as asking. There have been a lot of songs I hadn't heard before, but I don't know. If there's really been anything where I've been like, I need like five of these albums by this band. Not yet. Today might be the day. Well, hadn't heard that song.
Yeah, you know what? Today's got a possibility of that happening.
Yeah. All right, question two. Do any of you have any regrets about following a band when you were younger? I only listened to the Smiths through high school and missed out on loads of really awesome music through being a music snob. So did your snobbery ever prevent you from being into something while it was current, I guess? Like, oh, that's bullshit. I don't go for that. And then later you realize, yeah, that's pretty good.
I don't know that I ever was opposed to... If I liked it, I liked it, I think. I'm trying to think of a band that I didn't care for that I went back to and really appreciate now.
Kevin, you got anything? I mean, it seems to me that you pretty much like and or appreciate just about everything you hear. Is there anything that you ignored back in the day but have since rediscovered and wish you were into it as it was happening?
I mean, not so much that, but I do remember that in high school when the D Light had their single "Grooves in the Crotch." When that came out, "Grooves in the Crotch." That wasn't. I keep
forgetting. Oh, things. That's not wrong. I mean, that's a true statement as well.
What the hell, man? Anyway,
that was nice. What are they putting in the food at Caddyshack over there? This guy. Damn. Might have to go there after all.
In all honesty, I was in a band and we had a medley and we called it "Grooves in the Crotch." So. That's where that rolled out from. But anyway, when that song "Grooves in the Heart" was out, I bought the single, but I wouldn't really play it except by myself in my truck. I wouldn't play it in front of my friends or anything because we were all like into metal and punk and things like that.
Yeah,
that's the only thing I can think of that I was kind of closeted with my delight.
Yeah, I have more instances of bands that I liked, but I can't even listen to now. Which is the opposite of this question.
Yeah.
There's bands I wouldn't listen to, but now I like. I really can't think of any bands that if I liked them, I kind of denied it for some reason. Mm. I'm afraid I'm coming up empty here.
All right.
Yeah, kind of similar to what Kevin was saying, but I would say like the... like the Duran Durans of the world and the Flock of Seagulls and stuff. And,
yeah,
you know, it's like you didn't want to really let on that you appreciated it. But again, even the Flock of Seagulls stuff, I mean, the musicianship and the songwriting were on point, you know, just quality standpoint. It just happened to be, you know, straight up pop music. But any of those sort of early MTV bands that you know the chicks seem to like, which is not a bad thing, you know. You actually go to bands, see bands that attract women. It's kind of nice, but you know, bands of that ilk, I would say Duran Duran, Flock of Seagulls, stuff like that, you know.
Question 3. Everyone has a super group in their head, but if you could come up with the perfect festival, what band/artists would you love to see? Mine starts with Alice Cooper, AC/DC, Kiss, and the finale would be Queen, because I turned down a chance to see them and they never toured again with Freddie. Take care, guys, and all the best from over here in the UK. Thank you, Craig.
Thanks, Craig. Man. I want to say we had a question similar to this before. So we're talking a festival.
Yeah. He gave a 4-band example, so maybe we stick to that.
And you can grab a band from any era, apparently.
Well, I guess if you're a wizard like Craig.
He's foretelling the Mr. Roboto episode.
Yeah, he is.
That is yet to happen. Well, if we're talking a festival, I'm putting CCR on there.
Ooh.
I can't think of a better band for just like a large outdoor festival. At Nick Fest. You have to have CCR on there. See, I don't know that the bands would all necessarily go together. I guess they don't. Craig's
did. They don't have to go together.
Craig's did, but...
Yeah. Stanford Prison Experiment. Nick liked them, for the record.
I did. I loved
Nick
the...
Nick played their...
It was a 2-song single that a friend of ours caught at the Rage Against the Machine concert in 95 or 96. Okay. Some good stuff.
I didn't care for it, that's why.
Some good stuff by that.
Nick loved it.
I did.
Did you have the CD too, or no?
I ended up buying a few of the CDs.
Okay.
Yeah.
Good. Or was the single the two best songs?
That particular album ended up being the best one for me.
Yeah.
But yeah, no.
Okay.
the singer between the songs just kept saying, "Stanford Prison Experiment." For whatever reason, that's
well, you that, remembered
that
it.
The
that
stage
was...
banter was just the band names.
I kind of like that.
Yeah,
to be
honest. Which now that I think of it, is pretty great.
Yeah.
Send that my way. That needs to go in InObscuria.
There you go.
Okay. Yeah.
That would be a good one.
Yeah. Got a couple good ones in mind. I guess I'll just let's see. I'll go with the original Blizzard of Oz with Daisley and Curse Lake. Mm-hmm. I'm gonna go CCR. I know they don't really go together, but oh man, you know, for the heck of it, just because of the high energy aspect, I'm gonna go Fishbone.
Hey.
Just hopefully I'll be able to hear them a little bit better this time.
Angelo's got to turn his shit on.
maybe that was the problem. He was crowd surfing all the way into the lawn seats. I'll just go with give me. And you know what? I'm gonna write a wrong. Well, not a wrong, but I'm gonna make an impossible situation happen. Something that couldn't happen in 1980. I'm going to have the original Blizzard of Oz play, and I'm going to have Slade play also, instead of just having Slade replace them at the Reading Fest.
Nice. What do you have against Slade?
It's all Naughty Holder's look. Kills everything for me. He looks like a complete asshole.
You don't like mirror top hats?
Not really, no. I don't like anything about that guy's look. I've told the story before, but I got this book of rock photography at the local head shop, and when I got to the Slade section, I turned the page, instantly saw him, and I'm like, I hate this guy. And I don't care what they do or how good they are, I can't get past it. I'll never be able to get past it.
Did you ever see their first album? They were Skinheads.
Kind of against their will, right? That was the record company. Yeah, said, you guys are skinheads now. This is in.
Totally different look.
Yeah. Anyway, so I'll go to something somewhat...
Did he glue mirrors to his scalp?
Sorry. So I'm going to go with four bands that are somewhat... that are kind of contemporary, a couple of them. Two of them are touring together, we're going to be touring together in a few months, and two of them had toured together already. But I'm going to go with Rival Sons, which is still my favorite sort of current band out there. Add Dirty Honey to the mix, because them and Rival Sons are actually going to be a tandem, I think, over the summer. Throw the Struts on there, who I've actually, are both Jericho and our listener Kevin Jepson encouraged me to listen to them, and I've been impressed with sort of the variety there, you know, harkening back to a lot of the stuff we love about classic rock, but it's got a new vibe to it. And then Mammoth WVH, Wolfgang's band, album is great, heard great things about them in concert, so that would be a good four band bill for me.
Kevin?
Yeah, so we did we had an episode last year. We called it Ghost Fest, and the idea was that we could resurrect some bands that perhaps are no longer with us. And I think the lineup we had was pretty good, pretty solid. So I'll just mention a few, because we had eight songs, but I'll just mention a few. So we had Motorhead headlining. We had 24/7 Spies, so you get a little bit of funk in there. We have a newer all-female band from Sweden called Thunder Mother, who if you guys haven't heard Thunder Mother, they're amazing. We had Warrior Soul, which that's one that Chris knows, I believe.
Yeah, I'm a big fan of those guys.
And opening, I had a Detroit band called Seduce.
No, Seduce was in, were they in the Decline of Western Civilization Part 2?
They were.
Yeah, okay.
Well, now I have to put Odin on my festival lineup, so.
Only if you wear an asshole strap.
Only if you yell, Odin! Odin! Oh, accent the wrong syllable like that guy did. Was that the club owner? I forgot, but it was hilarious.
That was Gazari.
That's right, yeah. Odin!
Was Odin like the Orny Adams of the documentary?
It was, absolutely correct.
If you've seen.
Perfect, absolutely perfect comparison there.
Yeah.
Kind of, and I don't mean goat as in the modern greatest of all time definition. I mean the old fashioned. They were the goat of the documentary. Well, Chris Holmes kind of was too, but just kind of like the wreck that was kind of there being made fun of. You got the feeling.
So it wasn't like these guys are gonna make it. It was like these guys are probably not gonna make it.
It seemed like they were being. Yeah, it seemed like the main reason they were there was to kind of show the worst of this scene.
Yeah.
Kevin, would you agree?
Yeah, and I have a funny story. So the only time my band ever went to L.A. and we played the Whiskey, we were on the marquee, and then I look at the poster next to our name, and it was The Return of Odin.
Awesome. Finally.
Oh, thank God.
Yeah.
Like you guys, you guys made it just in time.
All right.
Everybody remembers where they were. Odin return. And before we exit the episode, a shocking celebrity death earlier today as we record this.
Yeah.
One of our favorite comedians, Mr. Gilbert Gottfried, has passed away.
Yeah, that was a shame. Shocking. To hear that.
67 years old, huh?
Yeah, and I was trying to look and see if he was ever in a music video, because you know a lot of in the 80s when you had to have a silly storyline or intro before the song started.
Yeah,
you got to have a comedian or somebody.
He
like
would have
that.
Been perfect. For
he was in a Weird Al video apparently. Third base. He was in a third base video.
Was he really?
Yeah, I looked at. I actually looked that up as soon as I heard about it. And third base and Weird Al were the ones that came up.
Do you remember the Weird Al one or no?
No, they didn't really. They just showed his segments from the video, so I couldn't really tell what song it was.
I might be way off base, but is third base the Pop the Weasel?
Yes.
Pop Goes the Weasel?
Yeah. Okay.
They had another video, huh?
They had a few albums out, apparently.
Were they Canadian, third base?
I don't think so.
No?
Maybe, I don't know. They were kind of dorks like your typical Canadians are, but I don't think so. I think they're probably your typical New York, American hip-hop group. Huh.
Because I would have figured he would have been in at least like a Twisted Sister or Rat video at some point, but
would have been good for it.
Yeah, Queens, New York City for third base. I'm on Wikipedia now. Also known as Three the Hard Way and Three Hard Dicks.
So. They've got my respect.
Yeah.
Oh, man. Isn't it amazing how terrible, how people name their band, people who end up achieving some level of success have the worst band names ever before they sign to the label sometimes?
Yeah.
Stone Temple Pilots being a prime example.
Now, what was that name?
It was Mighty Joe Young, too bad, but then I won't even say what STP originally stood for.
Was that serious? Or was that a joke?
That's what I'd always heard.
Just tell us what the ST stands for.
Shirley Temples.
Okay, yeah. All right.
What was
that's
Pearl
a Gottfried-esque reference right there. Oh,
yeah, Pearl Jam was... What were they?
Mookie Blaylock.
Yeah, that's a bad idea. Andy and I had a band called Leon Durham, but it didn't really take off.
Shirley Temple's You Know What sounds like a Gottfried bit, if you think about it.
Yeah.
Something he would dredge up and just would keep hammering away at it, not stopping until everybody's offended.
Yeah.
Yeah, that's a shame. That guy was great. No question about it.
All right. Well, Kevin, thank you for joining us.
Yeah, glad to have you on again and talk about a song that's a little more closer to your heart and everybody else's. So, righting that wrong, and now we just got to find that Uber driver and go kidnap Kendall Jones again. All will be right with the world.
Matthew is on his way. I just got confirmation.
Tell him to bring me a new office chair while he's at it.
He's just going
to
pull the chair out of his car and bring it in here.
Just throw it through the window.
No armrests, please. I will send it back if it has armrests on it.
You're getting a Buick Skylark chair.
I just want to thank you guys again for having me on, especially on Pot of Thunder Month. I mean, I'm assuming you called everyone else, whoever's has been on the show, and they just couldn't do it. But
no way. You were the first pick.
Yeah, and you're the person who I felt we've unnecessarily wronged in the past with that, subjecting you to what came out of the generator and not like pulling something else out that would have been more fun. So, you know, given it's anniversary month, we want to make amends and set things straight, and I hope we did that tonight.
Absolutely.
Well, thank you, Kevin. Can you remind our listeners where they can find you, your band, and your podcast?
Yeah, so the band is The Swear, and if you want to get any of our music, just go to Bandcamp, The Swear.
What's that going to cost me?
It's going to be free.
Oh!
Oh, yeah, man. Do you stream it there.
Are office chairs available for digital download?
Do we have a branded Swear office
chair? Oh, that's good.
Maybe I could 3D print a new office chair. Would work. And he'll break it the next time he's over here.
Yeah. And you could also, you can stream it anywhere, Spotify, whatever you use. And then InObscuria podcast. We come out every week, and you never know what we're going to cover. It could be anything in the spectrum of rock and punk and metal. So it could be anything from Japanese Visual K to bubblegum glam from the 70s. So all over the place.
Yeah, quality show. Yeah. If you haven't listened to it, check it out. If you're tired of the same old, there's at least half of what they have on every episode is a new discovery and something of high quality. So go check it out.
You're doing the Lord's work, Kevin. Thank you.
Much appreciated.
And kudos to an individual and his partner who go into it with the attitude of, we're going to do a podcast about stuff that hardly anybody else has heard of before. It's not what you would necessarily call a recipe for success. Basically, if you want to get into podcasting and hit a home run, come out with a true crime podcast. Apparently, that's all you got to do. Some sort of true crime, and you'll be able to stage a live set at the fucking Red Rocks Amphitheater or something. But, credit to these guys for doing something that they really believe in, and quite frankly and quite seriously, sharing their vast musical knowledge with the rest of us Neanderthals who only know of what's been force-fed us by radio and TV. So,
well, and let's be completely fair to my co-host. Now, Robert, all he does is just show up and react to whatever I bring to him. So.
Oh, he's got the what was it, Dirty Warren?
Dirty Walt.
Yeah, he's got that job of your podcast.
No, but that's part of the beauty of the show, too, is that he never knows I'm going to bring up.
Yeah.
So it's a true reaction that we get.
That's cool.
Yeah, that's all part of what makes it genuine, and, it's... like, you know, it's not rehearsed, and, you know, he's not faking that he doesn't know any of this stuff. And, you know, to me, that's what makes a good podcast, if it's genuine. So,
all right. Well, thank you again, Kevin. Thank you for listening. Submit a Yardo questions on podofthunder.com. Add some songs to the listener submission list, because I think we'll be back there next week. And you know what month it is. Long.